don't gotta be equal in a monetary fashion. It just gotta be befitting to the cause. You feel me? So you may not be able to serve a certain goal monetarily in the same capacity that I could serve you. So I may be investing in you, but you know what? You may have knowledge and a platform that I can leverage out and say, to me, this balances out perfectly. There's an exchange taking place. It doesn't always have to be monetarily equal, but the experience has to be fair.
Mm.
You feel me? So that's how we do that. This is African culture, though. You know what I'm saying? This
crazy, ain't no new shit.
That's barter and exchanging, bro. You know what I'm saying? You got 3 cows, I got 2 goats. The shit making sense. Fuck it. You know, I happen to need 3 cows. I only need 2 goats, but it's serious. Nobody gonna say 3 goats with 3 cows. That's not equal. They 2 different animals. But if it makes sense and both parties feel good about it, mm-hmm. switch. Fuck the money. Fuck the change. You know what I'm saying?
A lot of times, you know, just me when I used to go back and forth with certain people, like just about like, yo, Polight, I'd be like, yo, nah, for me it's inspirational because me starting my own business and doing certain things, I could kind of see where he's coming from. Like before, I might have not seen everything he's coming
from.
That's
what happens too.
You know what I'm saying? I'm like, but then when I start doing shit, it's like, yo, nah, homie, I can't do this. Like,
now you understand.
What am I getting out of this shit? Because if I come drive to you, waste my gas, waste my money to interview you and you, nigga, give me $50 at least.
Something.
You know what I'm saying? And it's not like me being like messed up. Like, nah, this
is. And people treat you like you horrible. Like, yo, fam, like.
Exactly. Yeah, so.
Like, this is a situation. You know
I find myself a lot of times, like, just defending the mindset of what you're talking about, because to me, I'm like, nah. Like, am I a sellout if I make millions of dollars? Am I now in the Illuminati or I'm getting raped or I'm doing certain things if I'm getting certain money?
That's right.
Because you know me.
In order to take this to the next level, you're going to need funding eventually. You know what I'm saying? You have humble beginnings, not to be humble the rest of your life. You feel me? So people that you see arrogant or come off very arrogant is only because they had humble beginnings. It's balance. It's my eye. It's law. It's order. It's reciprocity. It's mutually beneficial. It's polarizing an experience. You know, being polarized by the experience. It's saying simply, I have humble beginnings, not to be humble the rest of my life.
Mm.
You know, like we had to struggle. So why force ourselves into struggle when we start reaping the rewards or the benefits of the grind?
Why should I feel bad about my hard work?
That's right. We grind. We work too hard to get to this day. You dig what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. We work so hard to see this day finally.
That's right.
That for someone to tell me, yo, you got to be more humble. Are you kidding me, nigga? I've been waiting for this day so I can finally go.
I want to step one time. I want to hop up there. Yo, because I get motivated. When I watch the videos you have, I be like, see, this is, he talking about consciousness.
That shit is what hip-hop taught me. Hip-hop ain't all bad. You know, one of the things I got the most from hip-hop, I see you got hip-hop is real. What I got out of hip-hop the most is projection. You know, I got the clairvoyance part of hip-hop, right? Where I want to be and where I see myself. They made me envision the women that I always wanted to be with. Mm-hmm. To the point, like, I'd be staring in space. You'd be right in front of me, but you could tell I'm not really there. I'm so busy in the moment and seeing what I see. Niggas think I'm daydreaming. Mm-hmm. But I'm actually constructing the universe that I'm going to be living in right before your eyes. You feel me? Mm-hmm. So while they think I'm just, my mind is somewhere else, so you ain't never going to do that. And then another thing, like I tell people, I'm entitled. Your leaders and your teachers are entitled to being honest. That's what's making me so powerful and that's what's making me so successful. I'm being completely honest so you can't alienate me or use me as a coping mechanism. So when I have a shortcoming, you say, you see, this is why I'm not into consciousness because people like him failed me. No, I tell you my deepest and darkest secrets. Now I don't have none. You feel me? I told you. I got a thing for women with very big butts, very big breasts. You know, sometimes their breasts don't gotta be that big. I like their waist very slim, and I like their hips coming out. I like it how it looks on slim women. Mm-hmm. I like how it looks on thick women. I just love women in general. You feel me? And that's something that I be wanting around me in abundance. I love if I don't even have to be having sex with women. I just need them around me when I'm rolling through. I like to walk in a room and have like 6-7 women with me because it demands a certain level of attention. Like, who the fuck is this guy? I be doing that.
It's called a muse.
I be popping out, you know? in clubs, I try to get as much as my homegirls as possible. If I can get 10, 15 women up,
that's so good.
I come through like this by myself with just God. Them. And everybody got to stay around me. They can't go nowhere. And that's how I like the energy. And that shit feels so good. I live for that. And then they empower me because they all support me. You feel me? And they like it. Like, yeah, we like rolling with P. We like, yeah, you see how them niggas was trying to dance with us? Be like, nah, we only dealing with Polight. See, that thing, that's what it does for me, it make me go in the zone when I'm studying. And it tells me I could beat anybody in a conversation. It tells me if I'm grinding to get this money, I can out-hustle the biggest hustler. Because the women instill something in my spirit that makes me feel like I'm the greatest. I'm the best. Whether it's a caressing of my body part, a hug, kissing, sucking, sex, or just a simple smile. You feel me? That's what I get from women. So I just can't get enough women around me. You know, I love it. I'm trying to see how far I can go with this. That's me. Some people like to smoke. Some people like to drink. I love to try to collect as much as women around me as possible and to keep them around me. That may be bad. I don't think it is so far. So I'm just going with it. Mm. It doesn't compromise the integrity of my mission. I also really, really like cars. I didn't know that. When I got enough money and started experiencing these joints, I'm like, I actually like cars. I didn't know that about me. I knew I always wanted an expensive car, but I didn't really appreciate cars. Now I can break the cars down. And I can tell you why I like a Benz over a Bentley. And I can tell you what makes a Bentley similar to a Rolls Royce. I can tell you when the company split, okay, and when they went their own ways and how it changed the dynamics of the car. I can tell you this because I actually like cars now. You feel me? Like the dynamics of it, how it's created, how it's constructed. So much so that I even invested in a car company. Because when you start putting that much money into something, you should invest in the company. If you like shoes so much, open up a shoe store. Mm-hmm. Open up a sneaker store. If you like it that much, if you see this is a relationship you're going to have, right? Mm-hmm. Befriend the shoe. Make it where it's mutually beneficial. The shoe has you and you have it. Mm-hmm. You feel me? Don't keep buying the shoe from somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Be the shoe seller so mm-hmm. you can have access to it. So now it's not compromising. The shoes are making you the money or giving you the access to an unlimited supply since you know this is going to go on for quite some time. Mm-hmm. So me with the cars, I'm like, I really like cars. So I started investing in cars because I'm like, I really like cars. I can't see me keep spending six figures or stacks upon stacks just to get a V. Because mm-hmm. I'm wired differently. I know better than that. So after I get caught out there here and there, I'm like, you know what? I got to clean this up and make this into a hustle since I'm going to be here for a while because I like cars. Mm-hmm. You know, so
that's dope.
It's nothing wrong with liking things in this world. You know, I figure we should acquire it so we can let it go. I don't want to leave the planet and have these things pending on my conscience. I would like to say I've experienced it and I've burned it out. I oftentimes say if you don't burn out your desires will burn you out. So I feel it's imperative, a social imperative, for people to execute, thereby engaging their goals. You know, I feel like if you always like clothes, high-end clothes, fashion, buy them. If you see you still sustaining this fetish for clothes, get into fashion, design your own, you know. Also purchase it. You know, people say, man, you wear all these European clothes and all this other stuff. But I actually model for two of the brands that I be wearing. You know why? Because it only made sense after a while because I buy so much of it. Yeah. So I say, you know what? Let me show them how I be looking. But what I did, because I bought season tickets for the Lakers games, it was a great investment because I get to sell them back. I just made five figures off of one game. I spent four figures on a seat. If you look at it, what the seats are costing per seat for the year in the 82-game season, considering how much games is at home, of course, Kobe Bryant's retirement game made me over 20 racks. You feel me? Sometimes when I'm at the seats, people like, oh, he's spending all that money on the seats, and I show the tickets, $6,500, this, that, third. Yeah, but also understand I bought it for the year, so when I'm not there, I'm making money because people are buying the tickets, and I'm always doing double or more of my money. In this particular case, did five times plus because the seats went for over 20 grand for Kobe's retirement. Mm. One of my best investments. But what's this? When I'm wearing the clothes that I really like, I was sitting courtside so much over and over. They started identifying me for my celebrity, for showing up, being a socialite. Who is this guy constantly dressing like that? And I got picked up and I was able to start modeling the brand because I purposely was wearing the brand over and over courtside amongst Mayweather, amongst Jay, whoever I'm around, you know? And the photographer always keeps putting me up as celebrities for LA games or celebrities for Clippers games. So me wearing the same brand over and over and being decked out and me sending it, the celebrity photos that's being posted online, you put Brother Polight celebrity. You know, there's several different sites where you can see the celebrity images. Celebrity affixed to my name and their brand, automatically my publicist did what he had to do and I got picked up. And now I model two of those brands. So now I get paid to wear it when I used to keep spending my money for it. You feel me? So this is just crazy. After a while, shit just keep clicking. You know when you in a poverty stage, every time you get money, shit keep disappearing. You're like, yo, every time I get, oh yeah, I got something five stacks.
Fucking up. Yeah.
Shit working out. Sister need bread. Fucking light. Shut, light bill back. Credit card, I was gonna put this on, and before you know it, you thought you're gonna have that money for 2-3 months, that shit gone in the first week. You dig what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that shit is like that with poverty. But guess what? I can tell people it's like that with success. It come a time, you just be thinking, let me try this. It just works so quick. You just gotta get into the momentum of success. But that's what I mean by you have to cut off dead weight, bro. You gotta stop being around people who don't see the vision. You know what I'm saying?
That's
and
right.
Then people that understand and see the vision, but they scared to invest in it or work with you and grind to get there, lose sleep, abstain from sex. I know I have less sex than the average man who's single, and I'm polygynous. You feel me? I know I do. Now, I have my moments where I'm just spazzing, like, you know what I'm saying? A nigga shit can't even lift up no more. I'm like, fuck, I gotta hide from these girls. You know what I mean? That happens. You know what I'm saying? I try to get out of that situation because it's tantalizing. But even the best nigga, you keep going in. You know, you be just trying to talk to your joint like, damn. You know what I'm saying? I can't be doing this shit 3-4 times a day. I'm getting older. You know what I'm saying? I'm That's using my saving products. Shit ain't working. You know what I'm saying? So, you know. You can OD, you know, doing this shit 3, 4, 5 times a day and got different women accessible to you. You don't want to fuck up your weeks like that, you know, and then that's creativity you're giving away. So you got to be real scientific about when you ejaculate or when you injaculate. You know what I'm saying? So when you take all that, I wrote a book about it, Resurrection or Reserve Erection. And then you also got Open Heart Surgery. Those are real good books, right, that talk about sex and how to make things manifest using the woman to bring it into this world. No spooky shit. It could probably be wrong. I believe it's true, and I see things working every time I'm doing it. So I'm like, it's right in my world. I'm sticking with it. But it could be wrong. You know, I can tell you that.
That's real.
But it's working for me, so it's right in my paradigm. You know what I'm saying? I think of it. I tell the woman cooperate. Mantra it up. Keep chanting the same goal over and over, and at the point of an orgasm, be bringing it to fruition. You feel me? And it be working over and over, bro. I'm telling you, I'm on some other stuff with the way I be generating my success. But if I tell people it, they like, oh, you don't want to tell me the real secrets. But what happens when you don't have the resources yet? You got to use the sexual energy to get you there. You feel me? Like, the sexual energy is a catalyst. Your biggest resource is your mind. And your sexual force. You have that. You don't have to buy it from over the counter. You feel me? Like, you actually got your greatest resources to become wealthy. You have it. All you need is a vision, focus. Don't take your mind off it. When I got a goal that I'm on, I be pacing in the house. My wives and them know. They like, oh, you got a plan. And I cannot shake it. It's hard to sleep. Because I just know it's so real. I keep seeing it. I got to keep working on it. I go to sleep with the purpose of dreaming about it. And I'm orchestrating the way it's supposed to work. And I think about it so much over and over and over. It's like an objective focus. Like, if I say think apple, you close your eyes, you think apple. And then I say think about how the apple tastes. Bite it. What color is the apple? Red. How red is the apple? If you keep going over and over and over, there's a point where enzymes will start secreting in your mouth. And your taste buds, your salivary alimates will start being secreted. And you'll start really feeling this apple. You actually would taste the apple. You come out that motherfucker, you want the apple. I'm about to go to the store, let me get an apple. Suddenly you got a craving for it. Same thing with anything you visualize success-wise. If you can capture that thought and you can keep it consistent, and then you do this. You're having sex with a woman, right? And you're saying this. Every time I want to bring about that success, I'm going to focus on that during the course of sex. That's tricky, because at the point of the orgasm, you have a tendency to go blank. Mm-hmm. It's a fact. You'll be thinking about the thought, like, yo, I know, brother. Like, keep thinking about it. Then that shit get crazy. She back that shit up on you. She start wilding out, twerking with your shit in it. And you start forgetting what the fuck you was thinking about. So you in the sister, and you thinking about what you want to make manifest. You got to hold on to that thought. What's going to happen is a number of things. We could talk about the metaphysical part, right? But let's talk about this part right here that's real deep. What's going to happen, this is called emotional transmutation. If every time you have sex, when you think about that project that you want to see through, let's say I just need a book done.
Mm-hmm.
And every time I have sex, I'm like, yo, I need this book to be done by this day. I need the book to be done. I don't want to get tired when I'm writing a book. It may take long hours. I may have to do research. So you say to yourself this, I'm going to have sex. Every time I have sex, I'm going to think about this project and how it needs to be done. Look what's going to happen now. Eventually, you don't need the sex. Eventually, the book becomes the ecstasy. The completion of the book is actually going to be the orgasm. If every time you think about getting the book done, you're having sex, the energies merge. And now you get the same fulfillment when you're actually writing the book. And now you'll stay up longer to finish the book, because you're trying to achieve the orgasm, which is the completion of the book. It's called the doctrine of emotional transmutation. You think about it while you're having sex, and that ecstasy, that arousal, that excitement, okay, that comes from ejaculating or from her going through her orgasms, the emotions start merging in, and then your goal becomes synonymous with that. So now your work ethic changes, because your work ethic becomes sex. So this is why we say, with the man, he's the activator and the woman is the motivator.
Mm-hmm.
You feel me? When it comes to sex, it'll actually happen. Like, I had a real bad anger issue, so I started taking time out to study language whenever I was angry. This is emotional transmutation.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I'm angry, I start studying language. The language takes me away from the anger after a while, because I have to pay attention, because I'm like, damn, I don't get it. It's not working. And I do the language until I finally make the anger subside. What eventually happens is this: subconsciously, all of a sudden, I don't even know when I'm angry. I just get the urge to do the language.
That's crazy.
I don't even know I'm angry. It's just what's going on right now. We do it inadvertently. Some people clean up when they're upset, but they don't know why. I'm talking about reprogramming yourself. So transmuting the energy of anger into linguistics, to the point that you get the urge to do language because you're angry, but you don't realize you're angry. You don't realize the whole reason why you want to do the language, because something's bothering you. Well, you just progressively applied magic called emotional transmutation. You feel me? So this is what you want to do with sexual energy. You want to convert the sexual energy into the product you want to manifest, and then eventually you stop being so overzealous for sex, because now the project becomes your sex. That's how you shift the energy and the thought. But you got to be thinking about that when you're having the sex. And do it all the time. Then now you don't even need the sex all the time, because the work ethic becomes the sex. Because you push in to see the goal come through. So you'd be like this. Oh man, that feeling you get when you finally finish that project.
That's so real.
It's real, bro. Yeah, so you
so
know.
So real, because I feel that same way even every day when I'm doing what I'm doing with the company that I've helped build with my brothers and everything like that. It's like, it's euphoric when we get an interview with Smack, or like now we got these, we got Polight and we got Red Pill, and it's like, I envision this day in
there
a sense,
go.
You know what I'm saying?
It's
and
manifesting.
And it's becoming a reality. But one thing I wanted to talk about when we was talking about success and everybody getting money, like when the people see you, like me, I'm like, yo, he's with Mayweather, like, oh shit, like he's talking to Kobe, or like, yo, like these, you know, they done made a million Illuminati videos, all this shit about, you know, we done got caught up in a lot of this craziness, so we don't really know what's really happening. I know some of it is somewhat real and some of it is, you know what I mean, but what kind of impact have you had on some of these celebrities, and what kind of impact have they had on you?
The impact they have on me is
we came to this country. We were kings and queens, never porch monkeys. There was empires in Africa called Kush, Timbuktu, where every race came to get...